When our daughter was in kindergarten, she brought home a painting she had done one day and proudly showed it off. A bright red flower garden with a single rose towering over all the rest. And next to that, she had printed, "I live God." "Look," she said, "it says, I love God." It was only an accidental misspelling, but we've always felt there was something profound about that mistaken letter I. And to this day, it hangs on our wall as a reminder that loving God is, in fact, the essence of life. Our daughter wasn't intentionally doing theology that day, but her painting is a helpful way in for thinking about the unique work of the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. One of the ancient creeds calls the Holy Spirit the Lord and Giver of Life, but the very same creed says that Jesus is Lord and that the Father is the maker of heaven and earth. So in what way should we understand the Holy Spirit as both the Lord and Giver of Life? Well, just like my daughter's painting created an interesting play on words, there is a fascinating play on words in the Bible that helps us get to the heart of what's going on here. Because in the original languages of the Bible, the word for spirit is the same as the word for wind and the word for breath. In Hebrew, the words are either ruach or neshama, and they can mean spirit or wind or breath, depending on the context. Like in the creation story, it says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and then it says before anything came into existence, God's spirit, his ruach, was hovering over the water, and so the creation began. But later on in the Noah's Ark story, after water has swept away all life from the earth and God wants to recreate everything fresh and new, it says he sent a wind, his ruach, over the water. And the point is, whenever God creates, he does it by sending his ruach, his spirit. But there are even deeper layers here, because in the same creation story, it explains how God created the first human, and it says that God breathed into him the breath of life, his neshama, and he became a living being. Humans, of course, need to breathe. Without neshama, we'd die. But it's not just our breathing that keeps us alive. It's actually the very breath of God himself, his divine spirit. Like it says in the book of Job, the spirit of God, his ruach, has made me, and the breath of the Almighty, his neshama, has given me life. And not just humans. In one place, it's talking about all the living things in the creation, and it says, when God takes away their breath, their ruach, they die. But when he sends his spirit, his ruach, they spring to life. It turns out our daughter was painting truer than she knew, because anything that's alive and breathing, if it is alive and breathing, it's only because the spirit has breathed life into it. In that one sense, we all sort of live God with every breath we take. Of course, there's more to being alive than simply taking breaths, so maybe that's why Jesus explained that it wasn't enough for us just to be alive in the physical breath sense of the word. We needed to be brought to life spiritually, too. We have to be born of the Spirit, is how he said it. And he was talking about the way the Holy Spirit brings us alive to the love of God and opens our spirits to the life of Jesus. Because when God breathes into us like that, that's when we'll discover he is the Lord and Giver of life in every sense of the word.